Welcome back, everybody. Today is December 22nd. It's a Thursday. We're doing this early because the holidays are coming up. It's another amazing episode of the Southwest Florida Gamers podcast, and we're mixing shit up for you this time because Scuba's out. He's got holiday stuff up on his plate. He's got family visiting. He's got work stuff going on. But we have an amazing guest to take his spot today. We got the one, the only, the Bigg Myke of Game Nugs.
Hello, everybody. How you doing? They can't say it back, but okay. I know they're saying we're awesome.
They totally are saying they're awesome. We got a couple awesome comments. We got one person that says there's no video, which is like, duh. We're not choosing to show video because we're scared. And then someone else says bye. It's probably the same person twice.
Oh, okay.
I don't have an introductory little game intro to read off for you this week, unfortunately. We spent a little bit too much time trying to figure out how to do the live streaming again. It's not easy to remember how to set this stuff up, but we got it going here, so hopefully this whole process works out smooth. So no, this is your second time being on one of our podcasts because you were on the big.
But was that party live?
No, that wasn't live. But this one.
Yeah, this is my first time being live.
Yeah,
on anything.
This is our second time doing a live stream podcast, so it's pretty fun. It's kind of interesting. It really takes away the net from walking on the tightrope, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah, of course.
Yep, you can't mess up. No edits.
Well, you know, the thing is, when I do my show on Game Nugs, you know, obviously we're not live, so there's a lot of editing involved because you know we're pretty lax with what we say on that show, but Chinzilla, who you know, he's got a mouth on him sometimes. So sometimes I have to hit that censor button.
That's funny. He was pretty well behaved on the garage sale trip.
Oh yeah, yeah. But when he's like in an environment where he's got to be funny, he's off the rails, hilarious. And just some of the things he says sometimes could get us in trouble if we didn't have the net.
Yep. That's very cool. So, Mike, why don't you tell us a little bit about Game Nugs and what it's all about?
Game Nugs, basically, if anyone's familiar with like Game Grumps, which is another channel on the YouTubes, it's basically we sit down, we try to bring back the couch co-op feel of gaming, because I always feel like that's missing from our gaming culture today. You know, everything's online now. You know. But I want to give people who watch our show the feel that they're sitting on the couch with us, playing the game with us, or watching us play the game. Basically, it's just myself and friends sitting around. Basically, just what you would do, you know, back in the 90s, in the old school days of gaming, talk over playing a video game. And basically, we just do that, and we film it. And it's, you know, I don't know if I'd call them Let's Plays. But they're gaming videos. We play video games for the entertainment of others, and we say funny things.
Yeah.
Mostly at the same time.
It's kind of like, you know, if they start watching your videos and start to get to kind of know you guys and get in on everything, it's like you're sitting down kind of, while you're watching them, it's like you're watching a friend play, you know, kind of next to them, watching them play the game, and you get to know their personality and everything. So I like the videos a lot. They're a lot of fun to watch.
Oh, thank you.
So I don't know. I mean, right now it seems like there's so much going on in the gaming news, but at the same time, not too much. Like what's going on right now? Super Mario Run just came out, for iOS only. That's been out for a little bit, a couple days. I did download it. I did pay the $10 like immediately. And it's probably a $6 game.
Yeah.
It has a good amount of levels. I think there's like six worlds with four levels each. And they're very short. They're very easy just to reach the finish line. Even the end stages are not too difficult with their little boss characters and whatnot. The kind of prolonged challenge that comes in is each stage has 5 coins to collect. If you collect the first 5 coins, that's like the red or pink coins, and you finish the stage, then for that stage you have to collect purple coins. You do that again, and they're in different locations. The stage might switch up a little bit. You collect the 5 purple coins, and then the stage unlocks the 5 black coins. And so you collect those 5 black coins. So each stage has like 3 sets of 5 colored coins to collect. And once you do that for everything, you basically have completely demolished the entire game. There's nothing else to do.
Wow. It's, I've not played this game yet, but I've seen it, and it looks good. I mean, it looks like a really well-made game. It looks like an actual, like, a Mario game you'd play on, like, the Wii or the Wii U.
Yeah, I know Nintendo's, like, biggest issue is having, like, a good control scheme. And, you know, just any kind of, like, a D-pad on a cell phone screen sucks balls for the most part.
Yeah.
Like, a platformer-type action game. So they were pretty creative in coming up with just that endless runner and just the doing the one button to just to jump and
right.
And they were pretty creative with that. They tweak some things, like it's not like the very first Super Mario Brothers where you start to move forward and if you don't jump on that initial Goomba you die. No, in this game, like if you run into any kind of a small, like, one height level enemy, you just kind of, like, pole vault over them. Like, you do this little tumble, sort of.
And then so you kind of, like, lose your balance, right?
What's that?
Kind of, like, lose your balance?
No, he flips over them, basically. Just automatically flips over him, and he'll keep running. In the middle of that flip, you can, like, hit the screen, and you'll jump off of him, and in the act of that, it'll kill them, and then you'll keep running. If you don't do nothing, you'll just kind of flip over them and keep running, and the enemy will still survive.
Okay.
So they've come up with unique ways like that to kind of get around some of the limitations of it being on a cell phone and the control scheme that you have. But, I mean, it's okay. There's a couple other features to it. There's the Toad Rally mode, where you basically are competing online against ghosts of other characters in kind of this endless run mode where you compete to get the most amount of coins but before the time runs out. And then, depending upon if you win or lose that, you either gain toads or lose toads to add to your toad village, your mushroom kingdom, per se. And then, based on the number of toads that you have one, that will determine all these different things that you can unlock to, like, build your toad town up. You can like, kind of develop this little, you can develop your own little toad town mushroom kingdom area. So there's, they give you that so that you keep kind of playing through this toad rally thing just over and over again to earn these toads to unlock these different buildings to add to your town. But that, I mean, that's really it. Once you beat the main mode, there's not a whole lot more to it, and it doesn't sound like there's going to be much more added to it. So that's why $10. I don't know, you know, if it's really
right
that much value in there, because it is pretty short. But it all depends upon, also, I guess, your level of skill. Some of those black coin challenges can be a pain in the ass. But yeah, what else? What have you been playing, Mike?
Well, I haven't been playing too much lately. I've been having some back problems, so I haven't been able to sit in, like, one place for too long. But I did download Ark Survival Evolved for the PS4. Played that a little bit.
Have you got into that with Rambo?
I haven't got a chance to play with him yet. Our schedules have been conflicting with each other, but we'll get there. I've been kind of like messing around with the single player lately, just to get my feet wet, you know, because I'm not ready to go against other tribes yet, and you know, get my stuff like destroyed by other people yet. I'm kind of self conscious about that. I don't want to go to war yet. I'm not ready to go to war.
I hear you.
But I've been playing that. I started playing some Star Ocean for the PS4, which surprisingly I actually like. But you know, a lot of like RPG games I used to be into when I was younger, but my attention span has like shortened over the years. So like, you know, games with a lot of talking, I tend to not play as much anymore. But I will say that this game it's one of those games you think there'd be a lot of talking, but they do a really good job of like integrating the story while you're playing it. So like while you're fighting, they'll be talking, or there's no like, granted, I've only played like 30 minutes of the game, probably 30 minutes to an hour of the game. And so far there's been no part where it's actually just stopped the gameplay and had like so much talking. Like it's basically just been talking while playing.
So that's why you say surprisingly, just because you thought it might have been like a heavy dialogue game.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoy the Star Ocean games just because I like space type games, space travel games, which I haven't gotten to any of that in this particular title yet. But I did play the one for 360, and when I played it, I kind of got like the Phantasy Star Online feel, which I enjoy. So I decided to try this one.
You got not to like horribly interrupt you, which I just totally did, but. You got it. You should do a let's play of the SNES English translated Star Ocean.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
I've never played the one for Super Nintendo.
Yep, there's an English translation for it.
Oh nice. I might have to do that. Is it turn based?
It's kind of weird from what I remember. It reminds me kind of like a Tales of Symphonia game.
That's amazing. I love those games.
Yeah, you definitely should check that shit out.
You know what? I will. I'm going to. I'll look it up and check it out before I play it. And I'll definitely like to do a. I've been wanting to do a let's play on like, you know, an RPG game like I don't know Final. I kind of want to do Final Fantasy VII, but I know it's a long game and I don't have the attention span for that anymore. But I want to give it a try.
Did you?
Just any game like that.
Have you've played through Final Fantasy VII before?
Yes.
Okay. You should think maybe 6. I mean, 6 is actually, if you just streamline 6, it's very short for the most part.
Yeah. Yeah, see, the only I've never played anything before I haven't played anything before 7. I mean, I've played them, but I've not like, you know, played them, you know, like actually like sat down and enjoyed them. I've played 7, 8, Tactics and 10. I think the only ones that I've played in my lifetime so far.
All right, what's your favorite era of gaming thus far in your life?
Oh, man. So, I would say it's easier to say my least favorite, which is probably like, which would probably be like the PS2 Xbox original era.
Okay.
I mean, because, you know, I collect games on the regular, and when I'm collecting games, it's like, when I find PS2 and Xbox original games out in the wild, I'm kind of like the least excited about it when I find these games, because I mean, the games that I enjoyed in that era are so like far and few in between, and of course the games that are rare for that era too, like are, you know, obviously pretty rare.
Okay. Remind me to tell you a story after this story about rare games that you're interested in.
All right. Sounds good. what was I saying? Freak.
The PlayStation
about
2.
My favorite era.
Yep, Xbox games.
So, I guess PlayStation 1, I would say, is probably my favorite era. Not to, like, you know, put retro gaming, like real retro Nintendo and Super Nintendo on the back burner. Those were awesome and always will be. But, I mean, I think I was able to appreciate the PS1 era a little more. Because I got to an age at that point where I was like, you know, I actually was appreciating gaming and just not like playing gaming just because it was video games, if that makes any sense. So like, me and Chinzilla, we actually like had a great like time playing Final Fantasy Tactics, which is one of my favorite games of all time. We actually started playing the game at 8:00 p.m. one night. And played all the way through until 11:30 a.m.
Jesus.
did not sleep. And then I think we watched wrestling and then went to sleep till like 4 p.m. and then did it all again, I think. But that one, that's why I say PS1 is probably my favorite era, because I have the best memories playing games with my friends in that era. And Final Fantasy Tactics probably was probably the best time I had playing PS1. And not to mention the original Resident Evil and the Director's Cut, which I had gotten for one birthday, and we played that all day. So I'd say PS1.
So don't even lie. Don't even lie. An original Resident Evil, your first playthrough, when you went through that L-shaped hallway at the very beginning, you almost shit your pants when that dog jumped through the window.
Oh, yeah, of course, dude. I remember that game being so, like, the jump scares were real in that game. Like, forget Five Nights at Freddy's. Resident Evil, the original, was jump scares for days. But, like, Nicole and I were just playing the remake, the HD remake on PS4. And, like, none of that stuff even surprises me anymore. I've played that game so many times. So it's, like, it's really one of those games that you really have to enjoy the first time around. And then, like, you know, gameplay-wise later on. But, like, if you want the full experience, the first time you play is definitely, like, I don't know. Like, it's the only way to experience it. It's just, like, if you don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, and I remember, like, a year or so ago, I tried to show Louisa the intro to the original Resident Evil. And I wanted to show her that exact moment without her knowing about that it was going to happen when the dog jumps through the window. And this was, I was playing it on the GameCube, and I get to that point, and it didn't fucking happen. Just like, it was like something, like, almost like a rock hit the window from the outside, and it kind of chipped. They changed the shit up!
They did that on purpose, because you thought it was going to happen.
I know!
It happens on your way back, and on your way back through that hallway, it happens.
I was pissed! I was like, damn it! I was so excited to...
I actually did that the other day when Nicole and I were playing. I was like, okay, the dogs are going to jump through the window, and it didn't happen. I'm like, oh, man. Okay, well, now I know it's going to happen on the way back, for sure.
Yeah, those sons of bitches.
What really scared me in that game were the hunters, the big frog-like creatures with the claws.
Yeah.
Because that was like a one-hit kill. Dude. Like, just entering a room and like just the camera angles, not seeing exactly what you were going to see in the room, and then hearing the thud of their footsteps, and you knew something big was going to happen. Like, that was probably, like, the scariest part of the game for me.
I hated going out to, like halfway through the game, you had to go out to that garden shed area where you had to fight that big plant. I never liked going out there for some reason.
Yeah, I never liked exiting the mansion at all. Because you knew, like, you can open the front door. Yeah. Yeah, like, you try to open the front door and the dogs tried to come in, and then you close the front door. And, like, that's, you know, you're like, oh, I don't want to go out there at all. And then they end up in the house. So then it's like, what's the point of staying in?
Yeah, and the crazy thing is, like, you're fucking shooting dogs in the house left and right. Like, just open the door and shoot the dogs. And then leave.
I think you couldn't go out more because there was nothing out there to go to, you know? Like, you'd probably just be a sitting duck.
Yeah, and the game just would have been over, so...
Oh, yeah, of course. Of course.
But, yeah, no, that was a fucking... I remember, yeah, me and one of my friends growing up in back in my hometown, that we played a hell of a lot of Resident Evil, and we played. He had a PlayStation. He got the PlayStation early with that game, but we never had a fucking memory card, so we always had to start over. But we did We did it 100 times because it was just fucking amazing.
You know, I think Saturn did it right in that sense. They had a little bit of internal memory there going on when the Sega Saturn came out.
And one interesting thing was, for whatever reason, the original PlayStation had a creepy as fuck intro music that fed well into the original Resident Evil.
Mm-hmm.
It was just kind of a weird fitting.
That intro, though, is very, like, it's very memorable, though. Like, every time I hear it, I just get those nostalgia flashbacks
from Bruce hearing pimples. It.
Yeah, I guess you could call them that. Just it brings me back to a simpler time, I guess.
Hell yeah, good time.
I guess all intros for consoles do that for the people who played those in their childhood. You know, like, I'm sure somebody the GameCube intro is it brings them back. You know, I just it's pretty awesome that like just a little sound could do that. You know.
Yeah. Pro tip: you can plug a controller in the player 4 spot on a GameCube. And you can change the intro music.
Absolutely.
It's amazing. But where the hell were we going with this now? God damn it!
I think we were just chatting it up.
Yeah.
You had a story, though, you were going to tell me.
No, I was just going to say, you know, the reason why I even asked what your favorite gaming, like, genre was, or period, was because I was trying to help you hone in on an RPG to do a Let's Play on.
Oh, and, yeah.
And if you really haven't played much of the Super Nintendo RPGs, you got to dive in that shit and... you know, play through some of that stuff. I mean, that's right. Like some of the pinnacle crowning achievement art, you know, like just 2D RPGs that are available out there.
I think the closest I've came to doing an RPG Let's Play on my channel is Link's Awakening, which is actually more action adventure anyways. But I've never done anything really turn-based except for like XCOM 2 or XCOM, which is more tactical than anything. But nothing like Final Fantasy VII or anything like that.
Yeah, you got to find the one that you just sink into and wanna you know, dedicate that kind of that amount of time to, because they ain't short, that's for sure.
Right. Yeah, that's like those are like 100 part playthroughs, and whew, I have a bad attention span, for real.
What are we talking about? No, just kidding. That's a joke. So what's up next on the list? You were talking about let's debate downloading games versus buying what physical copies. Is that what it was?
So there was this thing like back a while back when Xbox One came out, they were talking about how like everything on this console was going to be like digital and there wasn't going to be no physical media, and everybody took issue with that, and they
everybody
lost a lot of players. Yeah, and it drove a lot of people to PlayStation 4, including myself. I do own a Xbox One now, though. I did get an Xbox One at the time when they changed everything, but I'm now more of a PS4 player because of that. But there are still a lot of people out there who don't understand the problem with digital copies, digital media, which was recently on Twitter. I don't know if you're familiar with the Game Chasers. They basically, it's basically like American Pickers, where they, you know, they go around and they look for video games and flea markets and stuff, and they document it and stuff. And it's a pretty funny show. Pretty fun show.
They call everybody chodes.
Yes. I think it was Jay who had tweeted out that, I don't know if you're familiar with the Scott Pilgrim game on the, online there. It's like a old school beat 'em up.
All right. I know, but it's based on like the comic. Yeah.
Yeah, it's based on that, but it's a beat-em-up, like an old-school like Super Nintendo beat-em-up. And he had tweeted out that they took it down off of the, you know, off the store page, you know, so you couldn't re-download it. And it got me looking through my downloadable games on Xbox Live. And there was quite a few games, surprisingly, that aren't there anymore.
What?
That now if I delete them from my hard drive, I can't get them back, and I've spent money on these games. And that's kind of it's a big issue, actually, because I mean, what is the contingency plan for that? Like, how do they you know, reimburse you for that? And these are popular games too, like not just Scott Pilgrim, but like games like Mortal Kombat 3 that I downloaded, which was a $10 game, Turtles in Time Reshelled, which is a very popular you know, series, you know, like. It was a very popular remake at the time. That's no longer available, and that game was like $14.99. So if you took, like, if you're looking at like Turtles in Time is a $14.99 game, or it might have been $20 even, and Scott Pilgrim, which is also another like $14.99 game, that's like $30 there. I'm out if I happen to delete these games from my hard drive. So what? I'm just wondering what could they do to like to rectify that?
Yeah, and I mean that. I mean, like, another issue is so that at least that online store is still up and running, even though the games aren't available. When these systems become next generation or, you know, past generations or whatever, right. I mean, those online stores, they won't even exist anymore.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
You can't get that shit. If your hard drive fails or something, you'll never be able to get it again.
Right. And that's kind of what happened with Xbox Live when, Xbox 360 became the norm, and they kind of phased out the original Xbox when they, you know, they shut down the servers for all the original Xbox games. They gave everybody like, I don't know, it was like a $10 like credit on their store and stuff, and that's pretty cool. That's at least something. But then, you know, you couldn't play games online. You couldn't play like Halo 2 online anymore. And so they were like, "Oh, well, we're sorry about this. Here's some money."
We're so sorry.
I don't think that giving a full refund for these games would be reasonable, because then they'd lose all their money, so it wouldn't make sense to them. But maybe like give people like a free download or something, you know, like, you know, like up to a certain amount of their choice or whatever, you know, like maybe a $14.99 download of their choice or something, you know. I think that might be fair enough, you know.
Yeah, I'm only familiar with Nintendo myself, but like, these companies really should, like, you know. So if the game sticks around forever, you know, whatever. I mean, if you download it on one system and it's available again on the next system, you should be able to just download it again on that next system and not have to pay anything. Or, you know, if the game's not just available for download anymore because, I don't know, whatever, the system... licensing or whatever
issues,
then, you know, get like a small credit or something like that.
Yeah, well, and that goes back to, like, we were just talking about that I just bought Ark on PS4, and that's a digital game only, and that's $54.99. so what happens when they decide to take that down and I'm out $54?
And that's a real fucked up situation, because I've been listening to Adam, and you don't know if, because you're like in a beta trial, right?
Right. It's not even like a full game yet. And I mean, it's almost there. I mean, it's like a complete game to play, but it's not a complete game.
But you have technically paid that money to enter the beta trial. It's technically not paying money to download the final version game, which they might charge you potentially. There's a chance. I mean, small, but there's a chance.
I would say that, I mean, I guess they can, but that would be pretty shitty if they did. And I don't know if that would be a good business plan to do that.
I wouldn't think so. I wouldn't think so.
Charge the people already played, who already paid for it. I mean, they give you, like, whatever they have of the game complete, and then they also have, like, I guess there's a DLC for it too. So you're getting all of that. So I don't know. I don't see them charging us again for it. And if they do, I don't see them charging us a significant amount, like $60, you know? If you've already paid, of course.
Hopefully not, but you never fucking know.
You really don't, though. That's a scary thing.
Interruption. Charles McDonald from the page says hi. What's up, Charles?
Hello, Charles. How are you?
All this live streaming technology is amazing.
I feel like I'm in the future now. Like, I've been retro gaming for so long, I don't know what to do anymore with this technology.
You just got to take it one step at a time. That's all you can do.
I sound so old when I say stuff like that. I'm only kidding. I have been following video games forever, so I am up to date with my technology.
What was the first system you ever played on? Or on top of that, well, to combine in with that, what was the first, do you ever remember, like, as a kid, the very first game you ever played?
The first memory of a game that I played was with my cousin, and we played Pac-Man on an Atari, but I can't remember if it was an Atari 2600 or an Atari 7800. I can't remember if it was the crappy Pac-Man or not.
the one with the flash pellets? Like,
my memory probably remembers it as the best Pac-Man ever, so it was probably the 2600, and I'm just like thinking that it was better. But I do remember that, playing that with him. Also, I remember vividly that my brother and his friends would play football for Atari in his room. And at the time, we lived in New York, we shared a room together because we were younger, living in an apartment. And I remember when he was playing with his friends and I wanted to watch him play, because it's video games, you know, kids want to watch you play. He would kick me out of the room and not let me up there. And I wouldn't be able to watch him play, so... I never got to play football as a kid, but I did get to get a glimpse of it. But the first actual console that I remember, like, playing fully, like one of my consoles, was the Nintendo Entertainment System that we got for Christmas. And the games I got were, I believe, obviously Super Mario and Duck Hunt, but also Excitebike was one of my first games I ever played in my memory. And I remember having a lot of fun playing it.
For the Atari, did you ever get to play Adventure?
I love Adventure so much. I recently picked up an Atari Flashback 6 at a flea market.
Is it and on when there?
It is on there, yes.
Oh, awesome.
And it is just as good as I remember it. It's a little pixelated square, and you're getting keys from bats and whatnot, but it's still, I don't know what it is about it. It's the seahorse dragons
that chase you.
it's a very simplistic game, but like when you're playing it's like there's so much wonder, you know. Like it reminds me of when I first played Legend of Zelda, you know.
Mm-hmm. Except like, yeah.
I mean, it's weird to say that a game earlier than Zelda reminds me of Zelda, but I played Adventure after I played Zelda, so that's why that is. But you know, like it's that sense of wonder where like you're not being told where to go. You know, and you don't know what's going to happen when you change screens, you know, when you go to the next screen. There's so much wonder and adventure, you know, that make it great. Even though it is a little square running around.
But I mean, it's very Zelda-like, even though it came out first. It's like you move one screen at a time.
Yeah.
You know, there's enemies on the overworld, and you try to avoid them. And there's items all over the place that you got to get to progress farther, so... I mean, it's definitely very Legend of Zelda-esque. It's like Zelda 0.5.
Yeah. I mean, you know. And, it, you know, it's not bad. I couldn't tell you exactly what your objective is in the game or where you're, you know, trying to go, but I sure as hell love playing it.
Yeah, I just know you have to... I think you have to use a spear to, like, kill one of the dragons that's carrying a key... And then you get the key, and it lets you open up a castle door, and then that takes you to the end or something. I don't know. It's been a while.
It's fun to play either way.
Yeah, give it a try. Definitely give it a playthrough.
Yeah, well, you know, the Atari collections just came out on the PS4 now, and I believe the Xbox One, I'm not sure. But they did come out on the PS4, I know. And so if anyone's interested in picking those up, if you're, like, wondering, you know, which one should I get the one with Adventure first. That's a pretty good start if you're into Legend of Zelda.
Good pro tip.
I would say.
So, next topic. This is, what an amazing segue this is. Do you want to talk about Baby Bird?
I could riff on Baby Bird for a little bit.
All right, so let's dig into this. What kind of, I don't know, probably of like the five people that will listen to our podcast recording, I don't know if they also watch your Game Nugs videos where you have already previously gone into detail about this.
I have a whole playlist about them. So if you want to follow the saga, it's right there on our homepage on YouTube. The Scumbag Reseller Saga. It is.
There's a playlist for it.
I made a playlist. You know, I started doing those videos and they started becoming our more popular videos. Like, I mean, we don't have very many subscribers on our channel to begin with, but when you see, like, a video get, like, 50 views in, like, 10 minutes, you know, like, for us, that's pretty good, right? Like, you're like, well, what's going on there? Like, people just want to hear the drama of what's going on there. I mean, it's just like, first of all, these people are ridiculous. They're just ridiculous human beings. And I don't know where they learn their manners from, but people are interested in seeing like people like this because it's not the norm, you know, it's interesting because the way they act is just so unbelievable that you would think I'm making it up, but it's a good thing we had that candid video.
I just on the spot came up with a brilliant new genre of YouTube video game content. We got to get some spy glasses, and we just go to these ridiculous resellers and just record the interaction with them. Like we'll blur out their face or, you know, auto-tune their voice or some shit so you can't identify them. But just to, I mean, a whole genre of video of just getting fucked over or just watching how bad these people try to dick people over on prices and, you know, just trade in credit and stuff like that, and we could just make a whole series of videos.
I think that might be called Flea Market Madness on Pat the NES Punk's channel. He's always talked about scumbag sellers.
He's got that one guy. I think he's got like one or two guys on his channel that he always goes to. But I mean, there's that Mario World in Flamingo Island. There's Baby Bird. All these people that we could legitimately just like wear spyglasses.
Yeah.
And just.
Chinzilla just went to Mario World the other day. He told me he goes, I just went to Mario World. Well, he hadn't been there in a while, so he wanted to check it out again, right? Because obviously, you know, sometimes like things change, you know. But he calls me up. He goes, "Yeah, I just went to Mario World the other day." I was like, "And?" He's like, "Yeah, don't do that."
Yeah,
just don't do that.
So, okay, for our listeners, Mario World's at this place this flea market called Flamingo Island. It's in Bonita Springs, right off Bonita Beach Road near 75. Oh, I think they're open like Thursday through Sunday or Wednesday through Sunday. And there's one video game store in there that are resellers. Just fucking dickwads, you know.
Yeah.
They and the worst thing about it is they got a ton of shit. Like, they got a lot of stuff. Some of it's pretty cool. I mean, it's all old, whatever. It's just a mixed bag. But
their pricing isn't consistent with anything, though. Like, it's just very, like, all over the place. Because I saw, like, a Shaq Fu for Sega Genesis for, like, $20, which is outrageous, I would think.
Yeah.
But they had Mega Man 64 sealed for $50, which I think is actually a pretty good deal. I don't know what their pricing reasoning is.
They don't have a pricing thing. It's just all over the place, but it's generally high. So, like, any boxed game will be like about $50-$60, whether it's right. NES, N64, whatever, you know, it's fucking up there. But
yeah,
that's the thing. You do your due diligence. I mean, you could find maybe I don't know, maybe a boxed fucking Conker's Bad Fur Day for probably like $60-$70 if they fucking had one in their store, but they don't.
Right. Yeah. So it's like a flat rate.
That's kind of what it seems like.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I can see that, but, like, on one hand, yeah, like you said, you might find something great, and you might find something outrageous.
But I went in
sometimes
there
I like that, though.
Yeah, it's a mixed bag. I went in there one time with a friend of mine, and I feel like the store is mainly owned by this one lady. And she has this guy in her life right now, which is a huge dick and raises the prices on everything. And I straight up told her once, I'm like, "Hey, this is who we are. You know, we are this video game interest group here, and we have, you know, a page, and we have all these members. You know, we would love to send people to your store to buy stuff, but your prices are I said, they're outrageous." And I'm just, I just let it all out. I'm like, you know, no one knowingly would pay these kind of prices for this kind of stuff.
Right.
I'm like, I would even be willing to help you price things, but your stuff is just so out of price. And they're just like, you don't know what we got it for. And I'm like, I'm trying to help you out. If you're the dumbass buying games for more.
Yeah.
If you're paying more than what they're worth, I mean, that's on
you. If you're going to have your own store, you should do your research on what these games are worth. That's how you make money, you know?
But, yeah, and it's just these fucking stores. It's like, how the fuck do they stay open? You know? Like, how are they selling enough inventory to not only pay rent, but pay themselves?
I couldn't tell you that.
Because they're like they're like established, you know, stores in these flea markets that are just there for all of time.
Well, I can tell you that Baby Bird's store isn't making any money in that place, and the only people buying stuff from him are tourists who don't know. You know, they're just on vacation and they're treating themselves. But no local gamers around here that are in their right mind are buying games from him at all. I can tell you that much.
Hell no.
Unless they're coked out of their fucking mind, and that's the only way they're buying from him.
you know, if you're interested, Rambo has got a he's got an in at Flea Masters. So yeah. Even if you don't want to go, did he tell you about that?
He did tell me. Yeah, oh, okay. He told me about this.
Yeah. So even if you're just bored some Sunday, you don't have nothing you want to like set up a booth for, but you just want to walk the aisles early, talk to Rambo.
That's cool. That's really sticking it to Papa Bear and Baby Bird.
Jesus Christ, those dickwads. But okay, so now we're talking about these fuckers, and we didn't even like explain the big fucking meltdown that took place.
Ah, yeah. We should probably explain that for the people who don't know. So I made a video not too long ago where I was at a flea market. Now, I wasn't intentionally trying to make a video on this, right? But whenever Baby Bird comes around, we know there's going to be trouble. And Nicole knows to get out the phone and start filming just in case something goes down and we need evidence. You know, I mean, this is not the first time they've confronted me. This is not the first time they've threatened me, if you will.
And you see him, like, out in the... Not at his shop, but out in the wild, like, at flea markets, hunting for stuff.
At the particular flea markets that I go to, I see them almost every time I go. Usually more on the weekends, but you see them on Wednesdays and Tuesdays sometimes as well. Depending on the time of year, I guess. But... This is not the first time that they've confronted me. There's been other times, so it's like it's not like this was like an isolated incident. This was very premeditated on their part. Obviously, it's just too ridiculous not to be. But they've been messing with. Now, I want to say, I just want to put this disclosure out there that I used to talk to these guys. They used to be decent people. I will say that to me at least. I talked to them. I'd have conversations. Baby Bird always was kind of a dick when he would talk to you. He'd always have to be the smartest person in the room. Well, yeah, you. Like if you try to know more than video games about him, he you're wrong. You know, you're always wrong in his eyes. But other than that, never anything huge. You know, his father, Papa Bear, actually went out of his way to get me comic books. One, you know, he actually because I wanted the entire Maximum Carnage series for the Spider-Man series. And he actually went out of his way to get me those comics and give me a good price on them. So I will say they used to be decent people. But it must have been somewhere down the line when I actually started getting more into like collecting video games that they became, I don't know if you want to call it jealousy or if you want to call it like, I don't know, maybe competition. I'm not trying to be a reseller like them. I'm just collecting these games to play them because, you know, they're games that I want to play. I want to have fun and hang out with my friends and play these games that I remember from my past or maybe new games that I haven't played before.
Yeah.
But they somewhere down the line, they saw it as a threat to them and their business, which they don't make any money anyways. So I don't see why it would be a threat to their business.
Fucking Future but, 500 fucking record business.
Yeah, they started getting more aggressive and getting more in our faces. And because my father, he keeps an eye out for me too. So him and the other and Baby Bird's father got into it once. I won't go into great detail about that, but ever since then, they've been messing with us and screwing with us. And he even almost hit Nicole with his vehicle coming into the flea market once. We were walking out, and he drove up like real fast, almost hit her. And then he claimed, oh, I'm just letting my kid out, you know? Like, first of all, the dude's, like, 20, 24, so he's not a kid. But he almost hit her, you know? And then when he – because he, you know, he lets the kid out, and then he drives into the parking lot. He drove into the parking lot and hit the tree with his bumper, like, going in. I'm like, you are an idiot. Like, what is your problem? Like, what is so important that you got to be such an asshole? But I confronted him about that, and that's when we really first got into it. And then he got in my face. We were chest to chest, and I was telling him, you know, like go ahead and swing on me or whatever. It was a big thing, but you know, so that's what, like, one of the first times. But this time, particularly, I was at a booth, and there's a guy I won't say frequently buy from, but I've bought from in the past. He had a Donkey Kong collection for Nintendo, or I don't know if it's called the collection, the classics, I guess.
Yeah,
well, it has like the Duck, yeah the classics. Yeah, he had that. He had Super Mario Duck Hunt, and he had Legend of Zelda, a nice gold, a nice clean copy, if you will. And I had, you know, the Legend of Zelda in my hand. I'm looking at it. I'm making sure it's, you know, up to my standards because it's been sitting out there. It's early morning. Things get wet, you know, from the morning dew. So I'm looking at it, making sure that it's, you know, not rusted over or not damaged in any way. And it looked pretty good. But as I'm turning around to go pay the guy for it, keep in mind, it's already in my hand. I turn around and the guy looks at me and goes, he already bought these. And I'm like, how is that possible? It's been in my hand and he wasn't even over here a minute ago. So I don't know. Oh, no, he already bought these. Baby Bird comes over and actually grabs me by the hand and tries to take the cartridge out of my hand.
And there is video footage of this part.
Yeah,
your channel.
You're kind of getting me from behind, so you don't see the physical interaction, but you see the actual interaction, you know, like of me and him.
Yeah, you see. You definitely see the puffy chest of Baby Bird.
And the cross, yeah, and the opposite of cross-eyed. I don't know what you would call that. Googly-eyed. He's googly eyes. I don't know. Yeah. He can see the whole flea market from where he's standing. I can tell you that much. But he's well, you don't see that in my video because I blocked out his face because they look like the kind of people who would sue. So
I mean, the flea market, that's open space or whatever, isn't it? I have no idea.
Really too sure. I'm not really too sure on the rules of filming in public. I mean, this was obviously not meant to be used as like a YouTube video, but I, you know, obviously I wanted it as proof because, you know, as soon as he came over, you don't get the beginning of the interaction because obviously we weren't anticipating this. But when he comes over, Nicole gets the phone out and starts filming because she knows, like, always start filming, always be filming if something goes down. So, yeah, he's trying to grab the cartridge out of my hand and I'm like, get the fuck out of here. You're not taking this from me. I had it in my hand. You're not buying something that was already in my hand. That's like going to the grocery store and taking something out of somebody's cart and going, huh, yeah, you didn't buy it fast enough, brother. You know?
Yeah, the last Thanksgiving turkey.
Yeah, exactly. You don't do that. That's not how you conduct yourself in society. So he's trying to take it out of my hand. And then at this point, like, I don't know what I don't know what to do at this point because, like, my mind is racing. Like, do I push him? Do I hit him? What can I get in trouble for at this point? You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever I do at this point, what would be my fault and what would be on him, you know? And I'm going through all the possibilities because I don't want to go to jail for freaking Legend of Zelda. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's for sure, you know? But obviously he's in the wrong, but what would be the appropriate response? I got aggressive and I just ripped it out of his hand because it was in my hand and it was in his hand because he grabbed the hand. He grabbed the cartridge trying to pull it out of my hand, so I just got aggressive and ripped it away from him, and I said, do not fucking touch me. You know, like, and he just stood there kind of like blaming my father. He was blaming my father for something that had happened. And I tell the story in one of my video of what happened between him and my father. And basically, my father had bought some stuff. He left it at the guy who was selling it because he didn't want to carry it around. And then Baby Bird came over, tried to go through the stuff. Yeah. And my dad told him, don't bother, it's already paid for. And that's what happened there. That's what he was talking about.
As soon as you said, don't take stuff out of my hand, he's like, your father did this to me.
Exactly. And he wouldn't stop, too. He said, and you don't see it in the video because I only used a couple clips. But he says it like 3 or 4 times in the actual video. He says it 3 or 4 times. Like, he keeps going back to that, like... Like, I think he might be autistic, you know, and I don't know. There's definitely something wrong with him mentally, I would say, because he's not full functional adult, for sure.
I do know Flea Masters does pay attention to their Twitter account. You should tweet at them just that raw video and be like, this is your tenants.
I could do that. Yeah, I could do that. But he kept going back to, your father did this to me 6 months ago. You know, he's trying to talk like a New Yorker. I don't know why. Like, he's not tough, you know? Like, I don't know. He's trying to intimidate me, I guess. I have no idea. But he's like, your father did this to me 6 months ago. And he kept saying it. He kept saying it over and over again. And it's like, that's the only defense he had until his father came over. And you see it in the video. His father almost threatens me. You know, He's like, did he pay for that? And the guy's like, he paid for it. Like, well, he did technically pay for it, but he shouldn't have been able to pay for it if it was not, you know, not in play, you know? So he gave him money, but I would not say he paid for it, you know? But his father comes over and he's like, did he pay for it? And the guy's like, yeah, he paid for it. He's like, now give it to him or I'll fucking, like, and he you know, he's going to threaten me right there. And then he stops himself, or fucking get out of here.
Like, or fucking like get out of here.
So I don't know if he stopped himself from threatening me because there was people around, or if maybe he knew he was being filmed. I don't know. I don't think they knew if they were being filmed at the time. I don't think they ever looked at the camera, so.
Yeah, I don't think they know too much in just general.
But I feel like him not, like, stopping his threat right in the middle of the threat, because people are around, I feel like he might have done this before, so he's had a little experience, like, you know, knowing what he could and could not say. But it all resolved itself when the guy who runs the flea market came over and said, well, it was in your hand first, so that should be yours, you know? So
that's
he tells the dad...
That's really cool of that guy, that the seller
that was,
give it
that's
to
the
you.
Way you handle it. Yeah, that's the way you handle it. And, so he tells me, like, yeah, it was in his hand first, so he's gonna, you know, it should be his first dibs on him, you know? And Papa Bear's like, oh, I wasn't here for that. Well, you weren't here for that, then mind your fucking business, you know? If you're not here for that, then you don't even know what's going on. Like, leave it alone.
So, all this boils down to, we are collectively putting together a letter to send to the flea master's management because of the dickishness and just I don't know just the fucking retardation that these people have.
Yeah, it's bad.
The business practices that they partake in, it causes a lot of other gamers that are in the know to not want to go to Flea Masters because we already know what's going to be there when we get there. It ain't going to be shit. So we're not going to
I could tell you from experience. I don't go there anymore. I just don't.
Yeah, I mean...
Like, you can still find stuff, but, like, it makes me not want to go there. You know? Just the thought of them being able to get, like, the stuff before we even get there, it's like, it's almost seems futile to even want to try to hunt there.
The two times we've set up a booth for Sundays, I mean, we found stuff always, right when they're opening and whatnot and early. And
right.
Both times, him and his dad and their buddy, the one arm dude, they're always walking around picking up stuff from every place before the gates even open. Mm-hmm. And so it's there's no point in going there because the chances of you are finding something are so small, it's ridiculous. So we're coming up, we're trying to put together this letter. I don't know, we got it typed up, we've been sitting on it for a while, but we want to submit it to management there and just see if we can get anything to happen.
You know, whether it works or not, it'd just be nice to get it off our chest, you know, like, just to try something at least,
yeah,
you know?
Because it's like, it literally prevents us from spending money with other people there.
Yeah.
Because we don't go there at all.
I've gotten some good stuff there before, dude. I mean, like, I've gotten some great stuff at that flea market, and it's just sad that, like, that's, like, one place that I don't have to, like, you know, that's one less stomping ground that I have to hunt for, you know, hunt at, just because, you know, I don't see the point if somebody can already get the stuff that I would get, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and I'm not, you know, and obviously other people can go before me and get stuff, and that's not the, you know, that's not what we're trying to get at here. But it's the point that these resellers, like, and when I say resellers, I mean these particular resellers, not all resellers. That, like, it's just bad that, like, they can get that stuff and put it in their store for them to quote-unquote sell. And it never sees the light of day again. Like, that will never go to another gamer, another actual, like, collector or gamer out there. It's just going to stay in their little glass case there.
Yeah.
And I can tell you that from experience because I've been to his store a few times before he had it out. And he had a Mega Man 6 under the case. Mostly all his games under the case were the same for 3 years, 4 years. Just the same games, exactly the same games. And they're not moving. They're not going anywhere. They're just sitting there collecting dust. Well, not even collecting dust because they're under glass, but just, you know, they're not entering circulation again, and that's not good.
Yeah. How's Blue Coyote's essay skills? Like, essay writing skills?
I don't know. She might be able to
I just need someone to proofread the thing that I wrote and, like,
okay.
fix the grammatical errors and shit, because the way that I write is, like, exactly the way that I speak, and it just doesn't look good in written form. Before we submit it to them, we need it to read professionally. Even though the idea gets across, which is the most important part, we just need it to flow eloquently.
There's a program, I believe, called Open Office. It's kind of like Microsoft Office. That's like, it's kind of like a light version of it, and that might help out a little bit. I think it's free too. I'm not sure.
I love free so much.
Openoffice.org, I think it is. Not affiliated or anything, but just in case you're looking for a nice cheap way to, you know, grammar correct.
I hear you. All right, well, we've been going at this for about an hour now. How about we'll just step away quick for a bathroom break if you have to. I know I gotta go take a leak.
Probably get to it too.
Yeah, we'll leave the live stream running and we'll be back here in just a couple minutes. I'm back. I beat Mike. I was quick to the draw with that one. So, while we're waiting for Mike to get back, I will go through some pickups that I got today. So, one of the things that I do is we grocery shop at Walmart, and I use the savings catcher. And after about a year's worth of saving receipts, I saved up like $50. And I bought a bunch of stuff with that money. The first thing to come in was, it's a boxed Zuzu Pets for the Wii. And it has limited edition Nutters furry animal in there. Pretty fucking sweet. Oh, here's Mike. I was just going over some pickup stuff that I got today. I was just telling them, we go grocery shopping at Walmart, and I use the savings catcher. And so we were saving up money for like a fucking year or so. And I saved up like $50, and so I picked up this Zuzu Pets for the Wii. And it has this little stuffed animal in there.
They still have those?
Yeah, I know. And I was like... This thing was like $5, I think, online. And then on my way home today, I stopped for a DS game pickup. I'll show you what I got here quick. I got 7 games for $20. I'll do the bad ones first. So I got boxed Hannah Montana.
Oh, sweet.
Boxed Nintendogs, Dalmatians, and Friends.
Right on.
The Sweet Life with Zach and Cody.
Oh, dude, the best one.
Oh, we got to talk about your Mary-Kate and Ashley. And anyway, I still got that other story to tell you. Emmanuel and Game Scooby-Doo. And then the heavy hitters here. Mario versus Donkey Kong 2.
Oh, cool, dude.
Mario Hoops 3 versus 3. And Mario 64 DS.
Awesome.
Yep.
You know, have you been finding a lot of Mario games lately? Besides those, like I've been finding quite a few like good Nintendo games lately in the wild.
Have you? I don't know.
Yeah. Well, you know, I frequent Capital Pawn, just any of them.
Yeah.
And often I can find some pretty good games there. I just found found Mario Party 8, Mario Kart Wii, Super Paper Mario, and.
Now, do they price their Mario stuff differently than their other listed game prices?
They used to.
I started running into that where originally they had every GameCube game, $5, whatever.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was like Mario, $20, whatever.
No, you're absolutely right about that. Because I used to frequent them. This is where I found like games like Contra for $5, you know, which is a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
that every Nintendo game was $5 before. Right down the board, doesn't matter what it was. Like Mike Tyson's Punch Out, Contra, Mario 3, you know. Everything was $5, which is not bad, you know. But then somewhere down the line, they started jacking the prices of like the higher end games. Like Legend of Zelda was $30. And I don't even think that's a $30 game to begin with, but it was like a $30 game there. Where like all the like lower end ones, you know? Even Tecmo Super Bowl then, or Tecmo Bowl, somewhere down the line they started $6. You know, they started fluctuating the prices. But at one of the particular ones I go to, they have a sign that says all Nintendo games $5, and I'm like, okay, that's all the Nintendo like NES games, right? And the guy told me, no, it's all Nintendo brand games.
So, Nintendo,
Nintendo, Wii. So I'm like, I went there the other day and got Punch Out, the new Punch Out. For Wii, yeah. And I'm like expecting to pay $5, and I asked the girl, how much is that? She's like, $3. I'm like, that's what? Fucking better than $5. So I'm starting to see some good deals, and I found Mario Party 8 for $5, and then recently went, I think we went to a Goodwill in Naples, and I found Mario Party 8 again for like $3. So hey, I'm like, man. I'm finding more Mario games.
Get out of my home turf, dude. Stay in your area.
we don't frequent Naples. We go there every once in a while, but it's a little far for our gas mileage.
Naples is a mixed bag. Like some weekends you can find that one fucking old person that had bought all their spoiled fucking grandkids every system and every game under the sun, and you get a great deal on it because they just don't give a fuck.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
and
of course.
It's either that or it's nothing because it's just old people that don't game.
Right, right. Well, I don't really yard sale or garage sale much, per se. I'm more of like a thrift store, pawn shop type of flea market type of person. I don't know. It's just I've been discouraged by yard sales too much. Like when I drive by and it's like, oh, I see a bunch of like plant vases, vases or whatever.
What?
I'm like, yeah, there's no games there. So I just get discouraged. So I don't really yard sale much.
Oh, man.
But
no, I'm just... I
have gotten some good stuff from yard selling, though. But I just don't do it a lot.
I'm like the exact opposite way. I'm like, I feel like the only way you can find deals is garage selling.
Mm-hmm.
I know Rambo has told us a couple times he paid for that phone app that like shows him all the garage sales in the area and stuff, and he's never had too much luck up in your area, but like Estero, Fort Myers, Naples area, he says there's a ton of stuff that always shows up. We should all do more garage selling on the weekend together in like just local area, because just the other weekend, 3 weekends ago now, 2 or 3 weekends ago, we went on a Pinellas Park trip, and we had, we didn't have that much good luck. We found a couple stuff, but
we had fun though.
That's for sure. That's the important thing. And that's the thing. Going out garage sale with buddies makes the whole world a difference, rather than just going game hunting by yourself. And even if you find stuff by yourself, it's not as fun as going out and really not finding shit with somebody or by yourself. No, not finding shit with somebody. I think I said that right.
It's better with friends.
Better with friends. Always better with friends. Now, okay, and what was... So finally, to wrap up my story that I've wanted to tell you since the very beginning of the fucking show here... What was the number one thing you wanted to find when we all went garage sailing up in Pinellas Park?
Mega Man Legends 2. That was my goal. Always my goal.
My buddy Mark Nestico, local guy here, started using Facebook Marketplace.
Mm.
Guess what he found in Estero for $10?
Oh, come on, man. Come on. Mega Man Legends 2? Did he got the Legends?
Complete.
What?
Yep.
I'm jealous, but I'm happy for him, though. That's awesome.
Yep. All off, just Facebook fucking Marketplace. Their new little...
Good deal, dude. Good deal, man. That's awesome, though.
Have you used that new Marketplace thing at all?
I've went on it a couple times. I haven't really used it to buy any games or anything.
That's where I found this DS lot on here in Naples. Was off there.
That's cool.
But, yeah, I mean, I don't know if I should give all our secrets away.
Well,
but there's a couple things you can look on online to find game deals and whatnot, and you gotta look every fucking day, because the one day you don't look is the day that your $5 box stadium events is gonna go up for sale.
And that's the truth. You do have to look every day, because like I said, I found those four games at Capital Pond for $5 a piece. I went back a couple days later and there was Punch Out. It wasn't there before, so you never know what you're gonna find. Even if you think that you just got a big haul and it's like, oh, there's no possible way there could be anything else there. It could be. You never know.
You never know. I mean, you legitimately. If you frequent some pawn shop or some thrift store, and you tell yourself there's never gonna be nothing fucking here, and you stop going, that's the very first day there's gonna be something there. I guarantee it.
Well, that's what happened to us at a Kiwanis thrift shop. I go there a lot, and I found some good games there before. But it's like when you find games there, it's usually months after you found the last good haul. It's not too frequent. But, Nicole loves the hunt whenever we go. And she tells me, oh, you want to go to this Kiwanis? I'm like, nah, I don't want to do it. I get because I feel like if I don't find something, I get a little discouraged, we all do.
Yeah, you lose hope.
Right, exactly. So she's like, no, let's just go. You never know. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't really want. We go in. I'm like, okay, fine, let's go in. We go in there and I'm looking through the CDs, and there I find, not complete, but still there, Mega Man Legends 1 in the CD section. So that's, that just goes to show you that, you never know what you're going to find anywhere.
Yeah.
And that was before I had a copy of it already, but it was just nice finding it in the wild. I had a friend actually donated it to my channel before that, but just finding it in the wild was pretty cool. That was one of my goals. I give myself little trophies or achievements to complete while hunting sometimes.
That's what we should do. We should come up with the game hunting trophy achievement list. Finding a boxed NES game in the VHS section or something stupid like that.
That's pretty good. You know what? That's a fun game to play. If everybody's going out with your friends hunting video games, make yourself a little checklist of things to do. Maybe make it a little more interesting, Give yourself an achievement hunter list. That's a cool idea, a cool little party game.
I love party games so much. It's the best thing ever. What else did we have on the topics list to talk about? I forget.
I kind of wanted to ask the question, why is the 3DS so popular this year? What is it, the Pokemon? Is it Pokemon that's doing it?
What makes you say that, first of all?
They're sold out every day, because I work at Target, and every day we're sold out of 3DSs ever since Black Friday. Is there something new with it, or something going on with it, or is it just because Pokemon came out?
I would say Sun and Moon is probably 95% of the reason why.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, Nintendo, they're starting to talk about Switch.
It could be that there's a lot more faith in their company now, with all this stuff, this new stuff they're coming out with. It's revitalizing them, kind of.
Yeah. I don't really know anything else. It's got to be Sun and Moon, because...
Yeah, I would think.
The best-selling Pokemon ever. Or some bullshit like that, I think.
I wouldn't put it past them. Especially after Pokemon Go was such a phenomenon. I could see that.
Yeah, with Pokemon Go feeding into it, everyone's getting back into the whole thing.
Not only people getting back into it, but new people who didn't know about Pokemon before, didn't probably play Pokemon before, never knew what it was, probably played Pokemon Go, and they're like, you know what? I could do this. I could see this happening.
Did you play Pokemon Go?
Yes. I actually...
Or are you
we were on break
Pokemon?
At work today. Yeah, I've actually popped it open today, and there was a muck in my break area. So
there was a muck in my break area.
My friend got it, but once I opened the app, it was gone. So I missed out on it. But yeah, I did open the app.
Pretty
I play it every once in a while.
Pretty soon, I think they've already released some Generation 2 stuff, but I think pretty soon the floodgates are going to open. And all of Generation 2 is going to be available to catch as well.
From what I understand, you can only get them through hatching eggs right now, but I'm pretty sure that'll change in the future.
Yeah. I don't know. Pokemon Go, like, it is what it is. I mean, it's its own little quasi-game sort of thing. Mm-hmm. I stopped playing it personally just because I'm geographically boned for that game. Where I live, it's like, was not established when that, what was that prior game? Quintus or...
I forgot what it's called. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. The game they made right before that they based off of.
Yeah, so that Niantic got all of its data from another game they made before Pokemon Go. And where I live now wasn't developed back then, so there's no activity where I'm living now. So there's, I mean, zero Pokestops, zero fucking Pokemon that show up in the wild. And even where I work, there's no, I mean, there's no Pokestops around my area, and just fucking Pidgeys. That's it. And so I just, you know, if I am going someplace on a trip or something, I'll pop it open and see if there's anything here. But I mean, I can't be competitive at all.
Right. Yeah, I was doing the whole competitive, like, gym fighting thing for a little bit, and that is tiring. And like, I don't have, like you said, this in our areas, like in residential areas, you don't get enough, like, action, you know, to play the game properly. And so, like, I'm far behind all these people who are in gyms with, like, 2,500 CP and, you know, like, they're, like, way up there. And there's, like, 10 of those in each, like, gym now. So I don't even stand a chance, you know?
Yeah. No, I hear you. I know we got this one buddy, Armor of God. He's just, like, prime location for his job, and he just sits there and, like, spams a Pokestop every 5 minutes at work. And so,
that would be the dream.
No, exactly. And so, I don't know. I don't even know what... He's probably almost close to max level now, even though it starts to become ridiculous to level up after, like, level 20. But, I mean, he's caught, I think, every Gen 1 thing except the region-specific Pokemon.
Right.
You know, and it's for him, I mean, it's just, he was blessed with amazing geography for that kind of shit. If you don't live, like, in a highly metropolitan area, I mean, it's just, it's hard to do anything in that game.
You don't live in a mall.
Yeah, if you don't live in a mall. Screwed. But I don't know, they're doing some shit. I know they, like, partner with Starbucks, so if you live near a Starbucks now, there's probably a Pokestop there, and...
It'll come back. It'll come back definitely strong. Maybe not as strong, but it will definitely come back where people will start playing it again.
Yeah.
Every time they come out with a new generation, it'll probably happen.
Oh, yeah.
Pokemon's never going to die.
For sure. No, Pokemon's never going to die. That's like, I wish I was in the ground floor in that building or that fucking corporation when it started.
Oh, yeah.
Damn. Pokemon Go, we got Nintendo Switch. They came out with... it was like their patents were discovered in the government database, some stuff that was just recently submitted by Nintendo, and I almost shit my pants because I don't know if you saw this or if you're privy to this. Yeah, you're not pervy to this, are you big perv? But one of their patents legitimately showed taking the Switch gamepad without the controllers, the Joy-Cons, so to say,
right,
but just taking that and inserting it into a headpiece, like the Samsung fucking VR experience.
So what you're saying is they've got VR capabilities, potentially.
They got a patent for that shit. That's all I'm saying.
Cool. That is really cool.
Nintendo Switch is going to do it.
That
all.
Would be amazing.
Home console, portability, 17 quintuplet different controller setups, and VR.
That sounds like it would be amazing. I'm stoked for the Nintendo Switch for sure. And I haven't been stoked for a Nintendo console for a while, but I'm actually like really like looking forward to this one.
Yeah, I think Nintendo is really understanding its roots or where it's come from quite a bit and is incorporating that a lot into the next system.
That's good. They need to do that. I mean, Nintendo's been around for, what, hundreds of years now, over 100 years now. But Nintendo Entertainment System has been around since 85, what, 83, 84? One of those years.
I think 83.
85, I think.
83. 85, yeah.
They've been around for that long. I mean, you don't just have kids anymore, you know, that like it. You know, you have adult fans, and they got to cater to them, too.
Adult children.
Adult children, yeah. That's a good way to put it.
We all aspire to be adult children. Fuck responsibilities, man. We got games
I
to
wish.
Play.
God, I just want to sit down and play games all the time. I don't want to have to work anymore.
Yeah, we need to just devise like some sort of company where we can just like help people acquire permanent disability so they can just stay home and get games, play games all day long. We'll like run them over with a car or something accidentally, like whoops. There goes your fucking femurs.
Maybe I can do that with my sciatica. Maybe I can get that. maybe I can get that going on where I could just sit around and play video games all day. Well, you know they say it's not good to sit around with sciatica, so I don't know. Maybe that won't be a good thing.
But that's you get yourself a VR headset. You can walk around in your living room.
Oh yeah. Okay. Did you when we were on our Pinellas trip? Did you see that guy playing the Batman VR?
I saw it a little bit.
That looks amazing. I want to get into that. Like, I've never... Because I feel like... I've seen a lot of reviews on this VR stuff online. And I feel like it does it absolutely zero justice to see somebody else reviewing it. I feel like it has to be a hands-on thing.
The first time...
I can only imagine.
We were at that GameStop. I tried... I mean, it was the same dude there, the same PlayStation VR demo setup. And I tried... a Space Fighter VR demo. I think it's Valkyrie, Space Valkyrie, or I don't know, Valkyrie mm-hmm. something.
I see something know. Like that, yeah. I know what you mean.
And the craziest thing that was like the most engrossing in the whole part of it, excuse me, was I sat down in the chair, he put the goggles on my head. It was just a regular controller. It wasn't like hand things. It wasn't right. like hand things like I look like I'm milking a cow right now. But it was just a regular controller, and as soon as the game starts, like you start in this little space station, but you're in a cockpit in a spaceship inside a space station getting ready to shoot out into space. And I'm looking around and I look down and the programmers were smart enough to realize that when you're playing this game, you're going to be sitting down, and the legs of the computer person that you were supposed to be, right. They were positioned exactly like how my man spread legs were positioned. And I was looking at it like, holy fuck, that's crazy. And your hands on the controllers, on the two sides of the controller, were like perfectly mapped to like two hands on opposite sides of a spaceship steering wheel sort of thing.
Right, right.
And so it was really weird to know that your legs and your hands were in this position and see the exact same position in the game.
That's awesome.
You know what I'm saying? So
yeah,
that was really cool. And then you get shot out and you fly around and you can look everywhere, and that's cool too. But it was just that initial moment when like I was looking at this body that is supposed to be me, and it was positioned exactly as how I was positioned, and that was pretty cool.
That's awesome. I feel like they're going to be doing some great things with VR. If you look at the beginning of like, let's say Xbox 360. When they first came out, their games were, I wouldn't say garbage, because that's not fair, but they weren't as polished as like the later games were, right? So I feel like this is only the beginning of VR, and I think if they stick with it, it'll be like the full-fledged experience later on. Like the possibilities are endless there, and I'm super interested. The reason I like this VR thing is because I have this game called Dead or Alive Extreme 3 Fortune, which did not come out in America. if anyone is familiar with the Dead or Alive Extreme games, then you know what I'm talking about. And it's supposed to have VR capability. And if this happens, you will not see me for at least 6 months. That's my guarantee to you.
You'll just hear like a.
You will, yeah. You will just you'll check in on me, but you won't like you won't get an answer. That's for sure. But I assure you, I will be better than all right.
You'll be motorboating across the Gulf Pacific.
It's a really weird concept what they got going with that game, but I'm one of those guys. Like I'm not ashamed to play any game. Like even if it is something like that, and I just want to check it out and see what it's like, you know.
So did you import that game?
I imported it from a website called PlayAsia.com. Took a while to get here, but I got it like maybe I ordered it and maybe got it like a. No, I had it actually express, so I got it like the day of. But I had to run out to the FedEx place to get it because they, quote unquote, I wasn't home when they knocked on my door. But I was. But
those
they never knocked.
Heads.
It happens. But yeah, no, I had it imported from there. PlayAsia.com is a place you can go to like import a lot of, you know, if you want like Japanese games with English, sometimes with English subtitles. This game, this particular game, Dead or Alive Extreme, though, if you pop it in your PlayStation 4, you would never know it was a Japanese game. Like it's all in English. It's very Americanized. So yeah, it's weird, but it works. It works fine. I get trophies from it. I get updates. So it works just like a regular United States
That's
sanctioned
awesome.
Game. Yeah, I was very surprised at that, and I'm very happy about that. But there's, you know, there's other games. Obviously, if you're looking for games that didn't come out in America that you want, I mean, I would definitely suggest Play Asia. There's other sites though. There's other sites you can go to, but that's the one I particularly use. I saw a couple YouTubers like review it and say it was like it was a good a good experience ordering from them. So that's why I did that. But yeah, not affiliated.
Here's a pro tip since we're talking about importing stuff from Japan. There's a website called Japanica Market. What they do is they're based in Japan. They will bid on like Japanese auctions, like Japanese Yahoo auctions or eBay auctions or whatever on your behalf based on what you tell them. And if you win the auction, it gets shipped to them and then they ship it to you. And of course you pay them a small fee.
Right.
But you can find a lot of good fucking deals on Japanese auction websites for Japanese specific gaming items.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to I got a Nintendo 64 DD complete in box with like almost every all the games for it except for like two of them, a Doshin the Giant expansion and a fishing game or a golf game. Those were the two games that weren't included in the whole thing. I got it for like less than $300 shipped, and that included the fee I had to pay, the shipping, and the what I bid it for on the auction. And I mean, that's $300 is a lot of money or whatever, but for it was a CIB 64 with, I know no one else can see this shit, but you can, Mike. But I mean, all these are just three of the 64 DD games.
Oh, nice.
And so you can, I mean, if anyone out there is looking for interesting Japanese specific stuff, check out Japanica Market. Get Google Chrome web browser, and because you have to submit like the URL of the auction you're interested in, so you just use Google Chrome, translate that stuff with their in browser translation stuff software, and you can get yourself some hell of a deals.
Nice. Good deal.
Nice.
Okay, all right.
So yeah. What else? What else is going on? What did we already talk about what we're playing right now?
Yeah, we did. At least you asked me. I didn't ask you though. What are you playing?
Not a whole lot actually. I'm kind of I haven't been playing too much besides Mario Run. I don't know what I'm waiting for, honestly. I don't know. I need to dig into something. I need to find like a good RPG or something.
Do you ever find yourself, like, collecting so much games that, like, you don't have time to play them all and, like, you just don't know what to start with?
Not only that, but I just feel like I don't want to dedicate the time to play them. Because, video games are great, but a lot of video games suck.
Yeah.
So it's hard to really find a game. Because I don't just want to play a game. I want to destroy a game.
Right.
That's the way that my brain works. Like, I don't just want to, for the most part, casually play a game. I mean, I want to max out my characters, get the best fucking shit for my characters, and all that stuff. So it's hard for me to just sit down and enjoy a level of crazy, just playing Crazy Taxi for like 10 minutes
Right.
or something like that. But yeah, I mean, I really just Super Mario Run. I pretty much destroyed that game. I got all the coins. I'm just right now just playing through the competitive mode to try to build my Toad Town up. I don't know. I need something. I'm jonesing. I need something good. I feel like I'm waiting for something, but I don't know what it is. And I feel like the secret answer to that is for March's release of the Switch. Like,
Yeah,
let's.
I think everything good comes out in November, really. You know, like everything like important to the game companies comes out in like the November area. So like I guess the next thing to do would be wait for the Switch to come out.
Yeah.
That's the next big thing, I guess, that we know of.
Cause, yeah, I mean, I think the last Wii U game I picked up was Paper Mario Color Splash, and Luisa's been playing, or my wife's been playing through that a little bit, but I don't know, that just doesn't really tickle my fancy, so
Right.
I mean, I don't know what I'm waiting for. I haven't been able to sink my teeth into anything.
Were you a big Mario RPG fan back in the day?
Like for Super Nintendo?
Yeah, for the original one for Super Nintendo, made by Squaresoft.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I had that when I was a teen, and it was great. It was I the first playthrough, it was amazing.
Do you feel like they should get back together and try it again? Do it again?
I think they should get rid of. This is the hardcore gamer in me. But Nintendo should just set Paper Mario on fire, basically.
Yeah, you don't like it?
Yeah,
Not a fan?
it's just, I mean, I don't know. Their last two.
I definitely think as a follow-up to Mario RPG, I didn't like it as much. I only played like a few of them, but I definitely like the Mario and Luigi games for the DS better than the Paper
Yeah.
Mario games.
Oh, yeah.
But nothing compares to that Mario RPG, man. Like, I don't know, just that memory's gone. It's, you know,
I
it's
don't know.
not.
It's such a mixed bag. Like, the first couple RPG Mario games after that were okay.
Right.
Like, the N64 one and the GameCube one. They were still pretty quasi-RPG-ish, even though they were a lot different. But I don't know. Just this Paper Mario stuff with attacking with stickers and not really having stats, and you gotta buy stickers to attack, and oh, it
Well, you
just.
know, that's Nintendo's MO, isn't it? Like they come out with basically the same game each time, but with a different gimmick. Like we've seen it in like what is it? The Mario Kart games with like Double Dash and all that kind of stuff. They always have like a different gimmick each time. Like, man, I can't think of any examples right now, but besides the Mario Kart one. But like, it just seems like they always have like Kirby games. Not that it's like fully Nintendo, but it seems like every Kirby game comes out like has a brand new gimmick to it. You know, like oh, you can, you know, now it's like Epic Yarn, or now it's like you're rolling around and you gotta draw on the gamepad.
Yeah.
So it's always like a similar game to the last one they came out with, but it's always like a new spin on it. You know.
Yeah, they
So like they've
always.
kind of been doing that since the beginning, I guess.
Yeah, recently, within the last generation or two, all their first and second party titles, I mean, they definitely all have like this huge change in their. I don't. What the fuck's the word I'm trying to think of? Just this huge like difference in them, almost blatantly obvious. Like you brought up Kirby, so you go from Kirby's epic yarn, where it's all fucking Kirby just drawn as yarn and the whole world's drawn right. as yarn, to Kirby the rainbow game where it's just mm-hmm. regular Kirby, but you're drawn on the gamepad
right.
and controlling ball Kirby, so it's all they all got their niche or their crazy little fucking
shtick. Or like even Legend of Zelda. Legend of Zelda's actually very guilty of this too, you know, like you have your Ocarina of Time, which is what you know was a pretty straightforward Legend of Zelda game. And then you have Majora's Mask, which dealt with the masks and time travel, you know? Now you got, like, Twilight Princess came out, and then after that was, what came out? Skyward Sword. What was the gimmick in Skyward Sword? I wasn't familiar with that, but I know there was a gimmick to it. I know you had, like,
I think Waggle Motes.
And, yeah. Well, I mean, they did that in Twilight Princess, too. But then, yeah, Twilight Princess, you had the wolf that you turned into.
I don't know.
So, like, you know, just they just come out with, like, I know they're trying to put a different spin on it to keep it fresh, you know? So, I guess that's what they're trying to do. But I think I just want, just a straightforward game now from Nintendo, you know? I just want, like, I want it back to, like, Bare Bones Legend of Zelda. I want Bare Bones Super Mario Brothers, you know? I just want to see a new version of the old games where it was no gimmicks, it was just the game.
And actually, I mean, Nintendo did that for us with A Link Between Worlds.
Yeah, even that, though, had a gimmick of, like, you know, going onto the wall and becoming, like, flat.
Yeah. I mean, so it has its gimmick, but at least it was a huge throwback. Like,
I think we might see this with, see, like, a brand new, like I'm talking about, like, with this new Legend of Zelda game coming out. It looks like it's back to, like, being just a Legend of Zelda game. I know it's open world, but...
Sure. Are you ready to poop your pants when this game comes out?
The new Legend of Zelda?
Yeah.
Breath of the Wild, I guess it's called, is it?
Well, it's going to be the breath of everyone pooping their pants, because that's what's going to happen.
Yeah. No, you're saying this in a good way, of course, right?
Yeah.
I'm all for it. Like, it's basically like, it looks like it's going to be like Legend of Zelda's version of Skyrim.
Yep, that's kind of what I think, yeah.
And I think that's what's going to... It's going to be the next big thing, because Skyrim has never not been popular. Every time they've re-released it, like, an absurd amount of times on different consoles, and God help me, I've bought every single one of them. but I think that's what's going to happen with this Legend of Zelda. This is going to be, like, the be-all, end-all to Legend of Zelda games. Because if you think about it, it's basically what the original Legend of Zelda was. Open world, you know, do anything, do what you could to get to the next area, right?
Yeah.
Like, there was nobody telling you, like, guiding you, you know? Like, it might have been quote-unquote linear, but it didn't feel linear, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely got the open world Skyrim thing. I think it's very open world like Skyrim, but I don't think like you'll be able to go into town and put like a basket over some NPC shop owner's head and steal all his apples and plates.
But if you saw the Tonight Show thing, they were showing like that you could take different approaches to completing tasks. You know, like, oh, you could go down there and fight those trolls or those moblins or whatever, or you can roll this rock down on them and murder them. You know, like that's cool too. You can do that if you want. I like that. I'd like to have the choice. Even if you're not really doing it your way, you still feel like you're being creative enough to do it your way.
Yeah. No, I had to play through the Wii U version of Twilight Princess. I played it originally on the Wii, but I had to play through it again on the Wii U just so I could get that stupid-ass Wolf Link amiibo and, like, max out its stats, so when I import it into the Breath of the Wild version... I'll have, like, this awesome wolf fucking Link sidekick to kick ass with.
That thing was amazingly $25 on Black Friday with the amiibo and everything. That was a good deal. I didn't actually pick it up. I don't know why I didn't. I was stupid, but I guess because I have Twilight Princess on two different consoles already, so. But I should have picked it up. It was $25. It was a good price.
Yeah. You get
especially
Nintendo.
For a Nintendo game. Nintendo's like the Disney of video games. Like, their prices barely ever go down, and they're always, like, people always want that shit.
Yeah, and the first party games, I mean, that shit's just gonna go up in price.
Yeah.
Over time.
Always.
God, we're just jumping around all over here. We're just, whatever's up on our mind, we're just talking about, but, okay, so, when we went garage sailing, I want to ask you this, because I didn't really get to talk about this with you, but... Did you shit your pants when Scott was bringing out all those totes?
I was kind of overwhelmed a bit.
So let's break this down here for a second. So we go out to Pinellas Park, and I'm okay friends with a YouTuber named Scott Squatch, and he's on YouTube under Video Game Sellers. He's got a fairly relatively large channel. And he doesn't live too far away from us. It's like an hour or two drive. And I ask everybody that I'm with, I'm like, should I ask Scott if he's okay with us meeting up with him? And they're like, okay, whatever. So we all go and meet up with him. And he's like, well, why don't you guys just come over to my house? And I'll bring out some of my stuff for you to look at. And so we're like, okay. So we go over to his place. And holy shit, I don't know what, 30 fucking, 20 to 30 totes of
lot.
Just games just brings
and
out.
Good stuff, too. I mean, like, high quality, like, high-end, you know, stuff you want to find, you know?
Yeah. And as a good gamer friend buddy, I mean, he was cutting deals for everybody.
Yeah. I bought a couple things from him. I got the Final Fantasy Tactics on PSP and the Railroad Tycoon for Dreamcast sealed.
No, sealed so one, yep.
I got a sealed one. That's not, I can't even play it, but that's cool. I love Tycoon games, so that was pretty cool to find.
Very nice.
Especially sealed. Especially for Dreamcast, too, which is something I don't find too much.
Yeah, I ended up... I know I talked about this on the last podcast, but I think I picked up the Wii U... Sing Party with microphone, complete in box, sealed.
My question to you is, are you bringing that to the next meetup? Because I want to play it.
Yeah, fuck yes! The next meetup is going to be, I'm looking at it right now, it's too far for me to reach, but we're going to do karaoke, like none other.
Hell yeah, dude. I'm up for it. I'm up for it.
We need to... We should discuss this now. We need to set up a meetup date. We've been talking in the Discord chat. Hold on. Let me pull up the calendar here. January. I think we're thinking the weekend of the 28th, which is like the last weekend in January. And it's probably going to be either at... It's probably going to be in Fort Myers. I think Adam has his... Rambo has his kids that weekend, so... It's either going to be at two Drop Game Shop or maybe at Armando's place.
Okay. I'm down. I mean, yeah. I should be back to a regular work schedule then, so I'm down for anything, pretty much.
If we're going to be singing, I should just... That's... As soon as we're done with this podcast, I'm just going to go into the chat and say, like, hey, if this is the weekend, I'm just going to reserve it with 2-Drop Game Shop right now so it doesn't get reserved. I don't know. If we're going to be singing, I don't know if we can be singing in Armando's place. With his... In his condominium.
Complex.
But I
don't want to be too loud.
Yeah, I'm pretty pumped for that shit. I think I gotta open it though, because I don't know if we need batteries or anything.
I don't think so. I think the microphone just plugs in USB. I used to be a big Guitar Hero guy when Guitar Hero like and it wasn't not four, World Tour came out. I used to be the vocalist when BX Punisher and I used to play. And
it was vocals for Guitar Hero?
Yeah, because on World Tour, it was a whole band setup. They were trying to compete with Rock Band.
Oh, sweet. I had no idea.
So they had great, great songs. They had Michael Jackson, I believe. Man, what song was it? I can't even remember. He's got so many good songs, but it was one of his songs that was on there. Survivor, Eye of the Tiger was on there, and I rocked that out vocal wise. So I mean, yeah, I used to be a big musical instrument video gamer at a point.
Very awesome. I remember I used to play the hell out of some Guitar Hero back in my college days, but that was when I was like getting stoned and shit, and I was playing Guitar Hero stoned. That was fun times. I remember that. That's for sure. I got a funny story about Guitar Hero and drugs. What a great intro.
Behind the music.
Yep. But there's this smokable herb called salvia. Have you ever heard about this drug before?
I have heard of it. Yes.
So it's an herb. I don't know where the fuck it grows. I don't know, maybe South America or some shit. And it's not federally illegal in the United States. Some states have made it illegal. Like, I think Minnesota, it's illegal now. Florida, it's illegal, I know. It's not like illegal in every state, but it's a hallucinogen, and you can buy it in states where it's legal, like at any smoke shop, porn shop, wherever the fuck, you know, any shady place like that. You can buy it right at the counter, no problems. And, when I was in college, I remember I had tried it once originally, and I'm like, holy crap, this stuff's crazy. So I was trying to get other people to try it at that time because it was a legal hallucinogen, and it makes you trip fucking balls, but only for like 5 minutes, and then it's done. It's just, you're gone, and then 5 minutes later, it's done, and you're back to reality. It's not like you hear about people on acid where they have bad trips and it lasts for like a day, or mushrooms or something stupid like that. So I had my roommate at the time when I was in college try it out, and we were playing Guitar Hero. And I was playing Guitar Hero. He was on the couch next to me, and he tried a hit of it for the first time. And you know on Guitar Hero how like, you see the notes going from the bottom of the screen to the top of the screen.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, he started going into his fantasy trip-out world. And he started talking like this. He was like, this isn't what he said, but it just kind of sounded like this. He's like, hello, man. How's it going? Oh, my God. This is getting crazy. Whoa! I'm out of control! Oh, oh my God. This is the end of the, you know, and it got quiet and loud, like that. And after he finally got done, I'm like, what the fuck was that? I'm like, I told him you got loud and then quiet and then loud and then quiet. And he was like, because he was watching me play Guitar Hero, in his mind had created the notes going up the guitar on the screen. It all of a sudden became this big wheel that was going like up and around in like this space for him. So when he was really close to me in his mind on the wheel, he was very loud. But when his placement on the wheel got to the back side of the wheel, he was very quiet because he was so far away from me. So in his mind, his voice was adjusting the volume to where his placement was on this wheel. It was so crazy. That's salvia. Don't smoke it.
It's like a PSA.
It's weird.
Don't smoke it.
You'll see stuff. It's weird. Don't do it. Crazy times.
You'll see stuff.
You'll see stuff all over the place.
You'll see stuff. You'll see things.
So, yeah, I don't even know. What else? Any other hot topics you want to hit up?
Not off the top of my head. I mean, it's in my mind. Unless you've got something.
I'm not thinking of nothing. I know that we haven't. I got to list the phone number here. So we didn't get any emails or any voice messages this time. So for anybody in the future that wants to leave us a voice message question or comment that will play on the podcast, give us a call at 813-444-7935 or shoot us an email at swflgamers@gmail.com. We'll read that shit on the air and increase the quality of this podcast. I don't know. Maybe. It's a possibility.
Yeah, responding to questions and reading comments, that's everybody. People love that stuff, man.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
But, yeah, I mean, the idea of this podcast is like the idea for Game Nugs. It's just like...
Getting together, chatting, and having a good time, right?
That's the thing. Like, I don't really want any kind of, like, a specific format. I just want people that listen to, like, be like... Hey, I'm listening, and I feel like I'm just hanging out with a couple friends, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome, dude. That's the way to go, man.
So
I feel like, you know, sometimes like I mentioned Game Grumps in the beginning, like that's kind of like one of our bigger inspirations on my channel. Sometimes when they're having a chat and they're talking on, you know, they talk over the video games and they're, you know, they have a chat about something. Sometimes I find myself sitting there watching it and I'm like, yeah, that man, yeah. They can't hear me. Okay, cool. Like I'll get into it because I'll feel like I'm there. You know, like that's really what we're trying to accomplish, is trying to just have that hangout feel.
For sure, absolutely. So, like, if anyone here is listening, is new to discovering this, I mean, if you live anywhere near Southwest Florida, definitely check out our page. We're all about bringing people together here and just creating a big, cool, awesome-ass community of gamers here in Southwest Florida. So, we're on Facebook. We're all over the internet. You know, just SWFL Gamers, anywhere online you can find us. Bigg Myke, how can we find you online?
We are everywhere. You could just Google Game Nugs if you want, but we have youtube.com/GameNugs, GameNugz, all one word. We're on Facebook under the same name, Twitter under the same name. So anywhere, yeah, just like you said, anywhere, just type in Game Nugs and we'll show up.
Very cool. Very cool. So, dude, we gotta definitely have you on more often. You're very eloquent. I like your content. This shit's good. I like this.
Well, I appreciate that.
So, all right. Well, we'll just cut this off here for the official recording. Everybody have an amazing holiday session that's coming up here, and we'll be back in 2 weeks with another fucking Southwest Florida Gamers podcast.
Stay safe, everyone.
Yeah.